Hey, PC World fans, Adam here with Gordon. And we just had Intel on our latest episode of The Full Nerd, and they brought some goodies. They gave us our first look at Intel 12th Gen Alder Lake laptop processors. Correct, Gordon?
Yeah, indeed. We got to see Intel's Core i9-12900HK, which the company at CES proclaimed was the world's fastest mobile processor, period, ever, period.
Period, all right. And, you know, it is one thing to have Intel take the stage and give us the benchmarks, but this was great because they came on The Full Nerd. We had four different laptops in front of us. You got to pick the benchmarks. You got to run them live on the air for everyone to see. If you didn't get a chance to watch the whole episode, you should. It was fun. We had Dan on. He gave us some great insights. But if you just are looking for the numbers and what the expected performance is, we have a good idea of it now. But it's not final, right?
No, not final. The laptops are pre-production, but they're pretty close. It feels like they're about a step away from rolling out, but that basically means not final drivers, not final graphics drivers, not final BIOS, firmware. There's just a lot of stuff that anytime you've done anything big, you know, there's things you still gotta bolt down before you ship it, but enough that Intel had the confidence to come out and do the testing live.
Yeah, that's pretty awesome. Thanks again for Intel for coming on the show. But what I wanna do is kind of go through the numbers that you got and just show them off back to back to back so that people can kind of get an idea of what to expect. Once again, wait for final reviews once they get in the hand of reviewers, but these shouldn't be too far off, right?
Generally not. Usually when you get a preview, the shipping part is pretty close often. I do want to point out the specs of the laptop.
Yes,
the
please.
MSI GE76 Raider, 12th gen, again, Core i9-12900HK. 32 gigs of DDR5 4800, GeForce RTX 3080 laptop GPUs, not the new Ti, but this laptop does have a higher TDP rating, TGP rating for the graphics card. Instead of 165 like the previous model, it is now 175. Not a huge difference. Also, different cooling because they now have a phase change heat spreader or phase change liquid metal pad that they're using that they claim is better than what they previously used. And also for the numbers that you're gonna see, the live testing we did, that was on Windows 11. The numbers you're gonna see here were generated on Windows 10. Windows 11 to Windows 10, not gonna make a huge difference. I'm in the process of updating my Windows 10 laptop benchmarks, but just so you know, and also, the specs of the other two laptops, it needs to be pointed out.
Okay.
Is the previous version of the MSI GE76 Raider, Core i9-11980HK, which was Intel's best mobile part. That's an 8-core CPU with 16 threads. Also, it had a GeForce RTX 3080 laptop GPU with 165-watt TGP. The other laptop is also an Asus ROG G17 SCAR Strix, I believe. These are basically all 17-inch laptops. The Ryzen 9 5900HX is, of course, in the Asus, along with the GeForce RTX 3080 laptop. But one of the problems with a lot of the AMD laptops last year is you couldn't get them with the highest wattage GPUs. Mm. This one had 130-watt TGP. It is a 3080, but it is a slightly slower due to the lower TGPs. Also, both the 11th gen and the AMD laptop had 32 gigs of DDR4 3200. So okay. DDR5 versus DDR4. GPU a little bit slower on that Ryzen, but these were all large 17.3-inch gaming laptops.
Okay, so lots of caveats. Wait for final testing, but let's get into the numbers. What's the first benchmark result that you want to share?
Well, we're going to kick off where everybody likes to start. It's Cinebench, Maxon Cinebench R20. It is, of course, a 3D modeling benchmark. You're seeing basically the multi-threaded, multi-core performance in R20. And the red bar is the Ryzen 9, the middle is the 11th gen, and the one on the bottom is that new 12th gen. So you're basically, with a multi-threaded benchmark, you are looking at the difference between two 8-core laptops and a 14-core laptop. And
bigger bar better here.
Bigger bar better, basically. And you're seeing, you're basically seeing the 12th gen pull in a multi-core performance 30% faster than the Ryzen 9 4900HX.
Wow.
And roughly, you know, the Ryzen is actually a little bit faster than the Core i9 11th gen, and the 11th gen versus the 12th gen is looking at about a 29.5% difference. So that Core i9 12th gen is really rocking the multi-threaded performance, as you sort of expected, because it just has more cores. 8 cores versus, you know, the math is not great. 14 versus
even though some of those are efficiency cores.
Even so, some of them are efficiency cores. Remember, the efficiency cores are basically sort of like mini 10th gen cores. So they're actually really decent, and they are they're not as powerful as performance cores. But when you need them to help haul things up that mountain, like you do in a multi-threaded load in Cinebench, they add a considerable amount of help to you.
Okay, that looks good. Well, what about the next one?
So the next one, of course, the world is not about multi-threaded benchmarks. Single-threaded really matters a lot. And frankly, single-threaded for a lot of people probably matters more. I mean, Photoshop, Chrome, Word, PowerPoint, a lot of things that people do really count on single thread performance, boosting up, hitting high clocks, although Cinebench is still pretty hard, so you're not going to always hit the highest clocks, but single thread is also very useful to go like, well, I don't think it's fair because you're looking at 14 cores versus 8 cores. What is it if you tried to run just one single thread? So like, suppose AMD suddenly had a 14-core CPU, or suppose they had an 11th gen 14-core. It would be sort of similar to that. So single-threaded performance is hard to pick up, but you're still looking at very, very, very respectable increases in performance for 12th gen. You're looking at, you know, 9.3% increase over 11th gen, which is a good part, very good part. That was sort of its advantage, a lot of its advantage over Ryzen 9 5000, which is great. And, you know, again, AMD versus Intel, the 12th gen i9 is 16% faster than that Ryzen 9 in single-threaded performance in Cinebench R20. So double-digit is nothing to sneeze at.
That's a pretty big jump. That's a pretty big jump.
Yeah.
And like you said, good indication for more real-world performance.
Yeah, closer. It's still pretty hard. I mean, maybe it might be an indicator of a single-threaded filter that's really old in Photoshop, you know. So,
and maybe some older games as well.
Yeah, you know. Generally, you know, you generally want single-threaded performance for a lot of things people do.
Okay, awesome. Well, what's the next one?
Well, the next one, we're back to multi-threaded. Cinebench R20 is older. There's a newer version. The difference is, basically, they take it, and instead of running it for one run, they now run it for 10 minutes. So the previous one, you know, a few years ago, it would take quite a while to run. These days, it just kind of blows right through it. Cinebench R23 is more of what they call the default, a stress test. It runs for 10 minutes. And we don't have a max score, but go look up a max score to see where the max falls. I will tell you, I don't think it's going to exceed that i9 12th gen. So again, more cores, generally better in a multi-threaded benchmark. This is Intel really sort of getting a little bit of payback for, you know, losing previously in multi-threaded benchmarks to AMD. You're looking at 16% over the 11th gen, and versus that Ryzen 5000, 12th gen i9 is 23% faster. So again, that's very decent. And this is in a much, much longer run. This is 10 minutes. So as you run the CPU harder, it heats up a little bit. Maybe the clocks kind of creep off, but you're still looking at double-digit performance over basically the best 11th gen and the very best Ryzen 9 part out there.
Okay, because I mean, I would say the 11th gen and the Ryzen 9 were actually pretty close, right?
Yeah.
You know, not too bad, but this is definitely a bigger jump.
I would say they were very close, and on laptops, unlike desktops, before Alder Lake, Intel had a hard time with Ryzen. Tiger Lake was actually very competitive. I mean, generally the better part if you want to judge the entire body of work, but still very close. Ryzen 9, 5000, Ryzen 5000 was a great part. Core 11th gen was a great part, still is. 12th gen, better part.
Well, okay. Well, what about the next one?
So the next one we're going to be looking again, single threaded performance. This is very important again for the same reasons. You know, you want single threaded performance to give you an indication of what you might feel in Word and in Chrome and in Photoshop. But again, this is more of a stress test. You're running harder, you're running longer, 10 minutes. Pretty good pickups though, still. You're looking at 16.6% over an 11th gen. Very double digits increase over 11th gen Tiger Lake.
Dang.
Great part. And over Ryzen 5000, you're looking at 23%. That's quite a difference from 12th gen to Ryzen 5000, and frankly for 11th gen too. Those are really good signs for 12th gen. Again, when it ships and it matches these numbers, I'm pretty sure we're gonna get pretty close to them though.
Dang.
So the next slide is Babco's CrossMark. It's basically a distilled version of its famous SysMark. It essentially tries to measure performance, you know, creating an office document, editing a photo, doing some video, and also this kind of cool thing where they look at responsiveness, how responsive a system is. Also, the cool thing about this is it is available not just on Windows, but also on iOS and Android.
Okay.
It is made as a cross-platform benchmark. It is based on open source applications, also open source compilers. And, you know, surprisingly, 12th gen actually gives us a respectable amount of performance increase. I think mostly because you're looking at a couple things. One, you have some video editing, you have some photo where the more cores and the more efficient P cores may matter. In fact, we're looking at essentially 21.5% over the 11th gen and 36.2% over the Ryzen 9 5900HX in CrossMark. One thing I do also want to point out, which is going to be worth looking into, is one of the tests, again, they talk about is responsiveness.
Mm-hmm.
They measure sort of how long it takes switching between applications or launching an application. Those are the kind of things that actually irk people more than just simply waiting for, say, a video to encode, or say, though it may actually bug you more waiting for an application to launch or to switch between apps than it may actually do an encode, because those are kind of things that kind of to burn you. And I want to give you an idea of is what we're seeing. I didn't make a chart for this, but the score for the Ryzen is 1257 in CrossMark for responsiveness, 1373 for the Tiger Lake 11th gen. So pretty close, honestly, a little bit faster for the Tiger Lake, but pretty close. I'm interested in this though, because this 12th gen Core i9 Alder Lake H is 1836. That's quite a difference in something that I would have expected it not to make much of a difference. So it's worth looking into down the road, but pretty cool stuff. That's CrossMark. New, you go download for free. It will upload your score to the internet if you don't pay for it though. Warning.
Okay. And that's one of those hard things to quantify in a review, right, is snappiness and responsiveness. So if there's a benchmark that can kind of run those numbers, that would be interesting.
Yeah, no, it's something I think that everybody should look into, because it may actually be the thing that people care about the most.
Okay. So what do we got next, Gordon?
So, of course, you're going, well, you know, I'm not sure I trust open source applications. I only trust stuff my company gives me from Microsoft, because big companies love Microsoft products. How fast is this new part in running Word, PowerPoint, Outlook, and Excel? And the next test is wonderful. That is UL's Procyon Office. Basically takes literally PowerPoint, Word, Excel, and Outlook, and it makes you run through a sort of simulated task, creating a Word document, resizing things, adding filters to make your Word reports really ugly and annoying for your boss, creating a PowerPoint. Very much, it's the office drone test, I would probably say you could call it, because it's literally based on Microsoft Office. And
all right, well, we got the results for them.
We got the results, and if you're looking at it, you're going, well, I don't see a huge difference. Yeah, I would agree. 12th gen still in front, basically 6.5% over the 11th gen Core i9, 5% faster than that Ryzen 9 5900HX. Not a lot to crow about. In fact, frankly, the Ryzen 9 5900HX and the Core i9 are, you know, dead even. You know, again, this is probably the wrong thing. If you bought a $3,000 12th gen, 11th gen, or Ryzen 9 laptop with an RTX 3080 to run Word, PowerPoint, and Outlook, it's not going to really matter. The one thing I'm going to leave out here, because if you are an extreme Excel esports competitor, you basically, in other words, you print money by your Excel skills, it does matter to have more cores. I don't have results here. I'm working on a benchmark that we will actually give us an idea what an Excel esports player should buy.
But maybe you're running Excel, crunching the numbers during the day, and you do need that high-end laptop for gaming at night. So what about gaming? What did we get out of there?
So for gaming, and I just want to say this again, we are not looking at final drivers, even though it is a 3080, not a 3080 Ti. Clearly, NVIDIA has new parts on the way. There's a lot of stuff going on with 12th gen. Everything is not nailed down. Also, there's a big disparity between 175-watt TGP 3080 and 130-watt TGP. But of course, Intel would say, well, it's hard to get those 165-170-watt 3080s in an AMD laptop. Okay, whatever. But I just want to point that out. It is, you have to always remember the GPU matters. And frankly, for most games, CPU is not going to rock your world. But the first one is Ashes of the Singularity Escalation.
Classic.
It's a true classic because this is a benchmark, a game that was created when DirectX 12 was launched. The whole idea of it was like, we use more cores. You got cores, we use it. Most games don't use them. Ashes of the Singularity Escalation was the poster child for that, the original one, Singularity before the Escalation. We run this 1080p. Using the crazy preset that basically throws more and more units and, more the highest graphic settings. And then also we use the CPU-focused preset. There's a GPU-focused preset, and then there's a CPU-focused one.
Okay.
The CPU one basically puts more units in. It's sort of like a, is it an RTS game?
Yes.
Yeah, it's an RTS game. I've watched it many times. I'm sorry, I've never played it. It's an RTS game. You have an overview of stuff, but more units, generally more CPU. That's what the benchmark is designed to expose a little bit. And, you know, you're seeing dead even between the Ryzen 9 5900HX and the Core i9 11980HK. And, you know, somewhat better. Actually, I guess that's pretty good. You're still looking at 11.7% performance increase for that 12th gen. Yes, I know it has a hotter GPU, slightly. But I would have expected for something to be closer to that 11th gen, because that basically has 165-watt TGP, you know, GPU at 3080, so it shouldn't matter that much. And then, frankly, you're looking at that Ryzen 9, you know, it's the score is basically the same in this benchmark. But the fact that Alder Lake is pulling up almost a 12% difference is pretty good.
Okay, yeah.
Pretty good.
Yeah.
That's a good show for it.
Yeah, not too bad. Well, what else we got for gaming?
Well, the next one is Far Cry New Dawn. And I also want to point out that it is something that has never run great on Ryzen. Previous, like the Ryzen 3000 parts on desktop, Ryzen 4000, it wasn't great. There's that sort of got to that issues that AMD had at 1080p with the initial thing. On desktops, that really changed with Ryzen 5000. They basically were faster than Intel's parts at that time. Even in some games like Far Cry, they were right there. A lot of that was due to the larger cache in the Ryzen 5000 desktop. Ryzen 5000 laptop doesn't have quite as big a cache. So they're sort of taking a hit there. And again, we're looking at 130-watt TGP GPU versus 165 and 175. But it's good to just see the comparison. Far Cry New Dawn 1080p ultra setting. Average FPS It's a pretty big win for the 12th gen, of course, 123 frames a second, 46% faster than that Ryzen 9 5900HX. All of that sort of stacks up, though. Higher wattage TG graphics card. Also, you know, the Ryzen 9 laptops weren't as fast as the Ryzen 9 5000 desktop parts in Far Cry engine games, so that's it. But I guess probably the better comparison is between the 11th gen, because the GPU is practically the same wattage, and you are looking at, 11, 12% difference between an 11th gen and a 12th gen. So still a decent pickup. I mean, 12th gen, 12% and 12th gen kind of goes together. But, you know, that's something that people like to get super excited about. I don't think it's, you know, world-ending again, but pretty decent.
Okay. What do we got next?
So the last gaming test we're going to run is Counter-Strike Global Operations CSGO 1080p high settings. This is average frame rate. I use the workshop map called FPS because it's very repeatable. Go out and download this if you have Counter-Strike. It's an easy way to get a benchmark score out of Counter-Strike without really, really working at it. This generally I would think is mostly CPU bound because it's not exactly for 3080. It's pretty easy to run. And here again, caveats for the Ryzen 9 5900HX laptop, lower TGP GPU. I'm not so sure that's everything behind this, but you're basically looking at 49% for 12th gen versus that Ryzen 9. You know, pretty big difference versus that 11th gen with 165 watt, almost the same wattage GPU, about 6.4%. So I would think the Ryzen 9 would get closer, but generally still pretty close.
Look, I mean, you're still talking about over 300 frames a second, so.
Yes, these are all capable of pushing the laptop's 360 hertz refresh rates, it looks like, in Counter-Strike. So definitely,
there you go.
Definitely eSports capable.
All right. We got one last benchmark to run. I know it's internet's favorite benchmark.
Yeah,
correct?
we saved the best for last. All right. And that is actually the official benchmark of the internet, and that is Geekbench 5. I actually like Geekbench 5. I think it's a very good tool if applied correctly. What I speak of is people simply looking at only one result and assuming that paints the picture of the entire world. And here we have a multi-core performance score for Geekbench 5. And you can see a 40.9% increase for that 12th gen.
Wow.
12900HK over the Core i9 11980HK. That is a huge difference over that 11th gen. Remember, this is a CPU benchmark. The wattage of the GPU doesn't matter in this particular test. And over that Ryzen 9, 56.5%. So yeah, all those cores, the increased IPC, it is just the 12th gen part. Internet is winning. It is winning based on Geekbench itself, because clearly that's the only thing that matters. We kid, of course, and if you are wondering, we looked up a couple of public benchmarks for the Apple MacBook Pro 16 with the M1 Max, 64 gig.
We did, and it smokes it. We don't need to even compare it, right?
Ah, well, you know, it's actually very good. I mean, you know, Apple, you know, as much as people want to give them a hard time, some people, you have to give Apple props. The M1 Max, M1 Pro are really good CPUs. The score we're seeing is generally about 12600 for them.
Yeah.
So, yeah, Alder Lake, 12900HK, still faster. Alder Lake ends up in a thinner, lighter laptop to a 16, we'll see. But, you know, honestly, for Twitter, for your arguing, you can argue on that right now. You don't even need to look at anything else. Go ahead and start your arguing.
Yeah, we got the numbers. The Windows is the best.
Yep. It is definitely the best. The last Geekbench score, the last actually chart I'm going to show off, it will be Geekbench single core. Okay. Because remember, as we said, with Cinebench, single threaded really matters. And the nice thing is the 14 core versus 8 core, the 10 core and the M1 Max, whatever. This sort of just sort of looks at the performance of that CPU for most applications that can't use all those cores. Pretty good. And this again is it's 12th gen is no joke. It was awesome on desktop. Looks like it's pretty awesome on laptop too. You're looking at basically 14.6% over a 11th gen Core i9 980HK, and you're looking at 27.2% over that Ryzen 9 5900HX. So,
but Gordon, where does the M1 Max fall?
Yes, we looked up some of those too, and so internet, start your ranting. 1770, 1700 is generally what I'm seeing for the M1 Max.
Okay.
MacBook Pro 16. Those are the public scores. I haven't seen one myself. So basically 1900 versus maybe 1700 to 1800 for that M1 Max. Bigger bar, better. So clearly the 12th gen has won the internet benchmark of Geekbench.
It's true. Any other slides to show off?
You know, I don't have a slide, unfortunately, but I do have something I want to talk about. If you watch our video, I did not get a chance to finish testing everything because I was running multiple runs of some things. So the last one is going to be Adobe Premiere Pro using Puget Bench.
Okay.
Their standard benchmark. I have a few scores that I've picked from that are recent, the latest version of Adobe from Puget Bench's benchmark database. You can go there and look it up. You can go look up other laptops. And also I pulled up a score for the M1 Max 16-inch from their database as well. And this is worth talking about because this is a hardware preview. It's definitely something worth looking into when we get there. A 5900HX laptop with a 3080 in it. The score is 693.
Okay.
Standard Puget Bench Premier. An 11980 with a 3080, 892.
Okay.
The M1 Max, 1324. Again, optimization is everything. If Adobe optimizes for you, it's worth everything.
That's a big number.
That's a big number. Now, here's the thing that might throw people for the loop, and we're going to see when we get final drivers, final parts, might be what the reality is, but you lose some, you win some. On the Core i9-12900HK, 1037 is the score I saw. So slower than the M1 Max. But again, we'll have to see when we get to final parts, but that is an awesome showing. That is the beauty of what you're getting when you get optimized applications. But you can't hide it. So we're gonna find out when we get final review parts, but I wanna bring that up because you just can't hide something. So again, this is just pre-production. We'll see when we ship. I kinda wonder if there's some driver issues going on with QuickSync, but we'll see. We'll see when we get there.
Yeah, of course. He did give those caveats earlier. I got two questions before we wrap up. Anything else you wanna cover before we wrap up?
No, I think that's it. It looks, again, this is a preview. We'll see when we get shipping parts, and every laptop, Intel, NVIDIA, and AMD give laptop makers hardware. The PC makers do their magic, making them go faster, making them beautiful, or giving you what they are. You have to base it on each laptop. But this is a pretty good feel for what you're going to see. Some will be slower. Some might even be faster, depending on the laptop. We'll see.
Okay, well, I got two questions to wrap up. The first one is, last week we sat down and made a video after Intel announced, or both AMD and Intel announced these parts at CES, and I said, hey, based off of the numbers that they provided, where do you think things are going to fall? Now, this week, we've actually seen some numbers. Last week, you kind of theorized that, hey, you know what, it's going to pull ahead in multi-core and maybe win some in single-core. It seems like that's bearing fruit, right?
It looks like it. I'm not sure that Ryzen, although it's something, I think Ryzen 9 6000.
Yep.
Especially in an H class laptop, I think it'll get closer. It'll get a good step closer. I don't think it's enough to beat. I think it's going to end up, 12th gen is going to beat it in multi-core performance. I also think they're going to have an edge in single core performance. We'll have to see what AMD can. I think we sort of still have to wait. But again, if I had to put my money down, I'd probably put it on 12th gen at this point. Where the wild card in all this is really about efficiency, because AMD is really pushing efficiency. AMD may actually really be awesome in battery life and maybe even performance on battery this time around. We'll see. I don't think it's really changing that much. We'll see it though, because Ryzen 9 5000 looks like, I don't think it won anything in the things that we ran. Obviously, there were some reasons why it didn't win. It had a lower clock GPU, but a lot of the CPU bound stuff wasn't exactly killing it. I also think AMD also played it very conservative with the 5000 parts. Mm. So maybe they are going to swing for the fences, and it might be slower, but it might be close enough that it probably won't matter to a lot of people. We'll see when we get there.
Okay, yeah. Well, so we've seen some first numbers from 12th gen. Hopefully soon we'll see our first numbers from Ryzen 6000, and we'll revisit it again, right? See how it all shakes out once we get those numbers. My second question, though, is, Gordon, we got accused during our interview that, you know, that there was huge fans off to the side, the table was cooled, they pulled the laptops right out of the freezer, this room was sitting here at 50 degrees Fahrenheit just to make sure these laptops were cool, and manageable. Gordon, is any of that true? Is there any way that Intel just came in here and totally pulled one over our eyes and really fudged the numbers?
No, I generally think, well, one, of the three laptops, only one of them was set to its high performance mode, okay. The gaming laptop. The other three were actually running the laptop's balance mode. And actually, they were actually really cool, generally. Fairly quiet, because in most of the CPU tests, there's so much excess cooling in these laptops, it didn't really change that much. Okay. But again, now most benchmarks, most reviewers would probably look at those laptops with them set to their highest performance setting. I mean, you probably should, because that's what you're going to get out of it. Intel, in their own testing, they don't even do that. They actually do their testing at the balanced mode. So that is something to be said. There was no crazy fan hidden water. So there are always differences. You can go buy five laptops, line them up next to each other, and some of them, they're not going to give you the exact same score. You will get model-to-model variances. I mean, not unit-to-unit. It'll just be different just because somebody had a bad day putting on the thermal paste that day, or maybe they didn't torque down the cooler enough. So it's going to happen. But again, these, I think you're going to get a pretty fair representation of what you're going to get. But again, shipping laptops are different. If we see a shipping GE76, that's probably going to be pretty close to what we're seeing today. You will see something different from Asus, Lenovo, Dell, everybody else, HP. Their laptops, they're going to be different.
Okay. And just to set the record straight, I always set the temperature on our thermostat to 67 degrees. So that's pretty much what it always is here in the studio. And it was no different today. So.
Yeah. In fact, I would say it was warmer today. It feels like the AC wasn't blasting and it was just the fan. So it was not super cold, and there is no liquid cooler under the table somewhere, so no.
All right, cool. Well, once again, we'll have to wait for even more numbers. We got AMD coming up. We got the actual final hardware coming up soon. So be sure to subscribe and check back later for more laptop coverage news. Thank you, Gordon, for running through all these numbers for me. There's a lot to take in.
Definitely. All right. Going to be a fun 2022.
Oh, definitely. Yep. We'll see everybody later.